January 1835, the first assassination attempt against the President of the United States. September 1835, Charles Darwin arrives at the Galapagos Islands. And on November 25, 1835, a man was born who would lead his family out of poverty at a young age, donate his massive fortune, build one of the largest steel companies in U.S. history, and whose leadership and legacy is forever known. His name? Andrew Carnegie. Andrew, son of damask weaver William Carnegie and his wife Margaret, was born on the 25th of November in Dunfermline, Scotland. His family was poor, but they were eventually able to live a slightly better life after his father's damask weaving business grew. They moved into a two-story apartment where the five looms occupied the first floor and the family lived upstairs. However, this new life was short-lived. The change from hand looming to steam looming destroyed his father's business. It is now that Andrew began to learn what poverty really meant, and from this came his resolve to cure the situation. His family's business declined as steam-powered machinery became more abundant, and a decision was made to settle in a slum in Allegheny outside of Pittsburgh. They sold off all their possessions and on May 17, 1848, left Dunfermline. Carnegie worked his way through a series of jobs, including one as a messenger and operator at the Ohio Telegraph Company, and as a secretary slash telegraph operator at the Pennsylvania Railroad Company. Every morning he would sweep up the telegraph office, and while doing this he taught himself Morse code. Andrew risked his job by taking a message when the operators were out, but it paid off for him. He was allowed to take messages when the regular operators were on break. It was from this event that Andrew's boss showed him the ways of a business person, and spawned one of the greatest leaders and innovators in U.S. history. Andrew eventually worked his way up to superintendent of the Pittsburgh division of the Pennsylvania Railroad Company and caught the eye of two company executives, Thomas A. Scott and company president J. Edgar Thompson. Carnegie became quite adept at investing, and one of his earliest endeavors was using his connections and skills to merge the T.T. Woodruff & Company, a maker of sleeping cars for trains, and the Pullman Palace Car Company. Carnegie was also an innovator. He founded the Keystone Bridge Company in 1865, which held a patent for wrought iron bridges, and in 1875 opened his own steel plant. In a desire to make steel cheaper while still being more efficient, he adopted the Bessemer process at his Homestead Steelworks plant. This allowed him to drive down production costs and create a better product. Carnegie was one of the first to recognize the benefits of mass production. He hired engineers and mechanized the steelmaking process so that it ran with the help of thousands of unskilled workers. They endured 12-hour shifts 7 days a week. The mass production allowed his plants to produce over 2,000 tons of steel per day and also drove down its price. He brought in Henry Clay Frick as a partner in 1881 and put him in charge of company operations. By 1889, steel production in the United States outpaced that of the United Kingdom. Steel production in the U.S. was mostly under Carnegie's control, and it was during this time that Carnegie became one of the wealthiest men in America. The rapid growth, coupled with the long hours and grueling work, caused dissent among the workers, which eventually led to a strike in 1892 amongst the members of the Amalgamated Association of Iron and Steel Workers at its Homestead plant, which caused it to shut down. There was little or no activity for several weeks until Frick brought in the Pinkertons. But all that changed on July 6, 1892. When Frick brought in the Pinkertons, a private security firm, to bring the plant back under company control, a short battle ensued, where a number of people were injured or killed. The company regained control of the plant, although there was an unsuccessful attempt to kill Frick. Carnegie's growing wealth enabled him to profit from the Depression of the 1890s. When others faced bankruptcy, he managed to gobble up steel production facilities, and in 1901, he accepted J.P. Morgan's offer to buy all of his steel holdings for $500 million, which made him the world's richest man. In 1868, at age 33, Carnegie wrote a letter to himself declaring that he would only work for two more years and thereafter live on an income of $50,000 per year and devote his life to benevolent purposes, such as philanthropy and education. Beginning in the 1870s, he began working on achieving those goals in that letter. He donated his first free public library in 1881 to his hometown of Dunfermline in Scotland. And in the United States, 2,500 libraries were built and equipped with Carnegie funds. He also donated money to universities and centers of learning, including Carnegie Mellon University and its engineering program, the Carnegie Institute of Technology. the Carnegie Trust for the Universities of Scotland, the Tuskegee Institute, and the Carnegie Institution of Science in Washington, D.C. In 1902, he also established a pension fund for teachers with a $10 million donation. He used his money to found the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace in 1910. And in 1911, Carnegie created the Carnegie Corporation and endowed it with the majority of his remaining wealth so the corporation could continue his philanthropic initiatives after his death. When it was established, the Carnegie Corporation was the largest single philanthropic trust ever created, with $135 million in assets. Andrew Carnegie died on August 11, 1919. By the time of his death, he had donated over $350 million, which would be around $4.8 billion today. He is the definition of a rags-to-riches story, going from earning just $4 a day to over $25 million a year. And through his relentless effort to drive down production costs and increase his profits, he caused the largest period of growth in the U.S. steel industry, surpassing the production of the United Kingdom. What is more amazing is that even after working so hard for his money, he decided to give away over 90% of it. The money went on to build over 2,500 libraries, support universities, and even help to establish a pension fund for teachers. Andrew Carnegie's leadership prowess and legacy will be forever known.
The man who dies rich dies disgraced. Andrew Carnegie.